I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
Okay, welcome back, my people. In our first lecture on this general topic, we saw that Justice Frankfurter concluded in Gobitis in 1940 that the Supreme Court could not be the school board for the country. He said, quote, "So long as the remedial channels of the democratic process remain open and unobstructed," end quote, "then groups like the Jehovah's Witnesses would have to engage in politics to win exemptions from state or local laws. The Supreme Court would only step in as a sort of backstop in egregious cases. So long as the court is looking at what he calls a general law not aimed at the promotion or restriction of religious beliefs, it's going to uphold that law." Now, in his dissent from Gobitis, Justice Stone took exception with this reliance on legislatures to accommodate what Frankfurter called individual idiosyncrasies, what we might refer to instead as individual conscientious beliefs. Stone says this on page 606. He says, "The Constitution expresses more than the conviction of the people that democratic processes must be preserved at all costs. It is also an expression of faith and a command that freedom of mind and spirit must be preserved, a command which government must obey if it is to adhere to that justice and moderation without which no free government can exist." So Stone is putting emphasis here not just on the character of the state laws that the court is looking at, that they be general, for instance, but on the freedom of mind and spirit of the individual, and how much room is being given to that freedom. And we know that this second emphasis is characteristic of balancing tests. It was when the Pierce decision said, we also need to consider those incursions upon individual freedom and start to weigh them against the state laws. That was when the Pierce decision started to emerge a bit from the Meyer decision and start to create balancing tests. Now, just 3 years later, it seems that Justice Stone's dissent from 1940 had apparently won over the court, because in West Virginia versus Barnett, the court relied more on principles of individual freedom than it did on democratic legislatures, because they heard an almost identical case again. And you might want to ask me in class at some point why the court is hearing these almost identical cases repeatedly over time. There's a strong reason for it. You'll start to get the sense of it here, because they heard an almost identical case. Again, it was about Jehovah's Witnesses objecting to the flag salute, and they decided to strike down that flag salute law, right? They hear these identical cases in part when they want to establish new precedents, new rules, as it were. So there's a famous quote from Barnett, which I'm going to show you right here in front of you. On page 642, Justice Jackson says, "If there is any fixed star in our constitutional constellation, it is that no official, high or petty, can prescribe what shall be orthodox in politics, nationalism, religion, or other matters of opinion, or force citizens to confess by word or act their faith therein." Justice Jackson here says, no official can prescribe. So legislatures, no matter what they say, individual freedom comes first, or at the very least, it's given serious weight in the balance that the court will perform. So what caused the court to change its mind so rapidly, just 3 years after Gobitis, and how did they justify this decision? Well, the first thing I want to suggest to you is that times had changed, history had changed. I want to show you here in front of you a picture of the flag salute from the 1940s. And here's what happened when children saluted the flag in their classrooms. They started with their right hand over their heart, and while they were speaking, they raised it in a palm-up, stiff-arm salute to the flag. And they said these words. So imagine them raising their arms to this final salute while saying these words: "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So we should see that the backdrop to this whole issue is that the flag salute that was used at the time looks uncomfortably like a salute to Hitler, who was, in 1943, although not yet in 1940, America's enemy in World War II. The flag salute by 1943 brought to people's minds more about enforced obedience and the denial of religious liberty, in fact, the worst possible denial, the worst forms of religious persecution, because people were well aware by 1943 of Hitler's horrid hatred of Jews. They were well aware of Kristallnacht, which happened in 1938, and they were well aware, or they became aware, of the Holocaust as well. But there's more to it than just this historical awareness and what the salute looked like to people in 1943, because Barnett also uses an entirely different theory of liberty. The first thing that the Barnett decision really questions about Gobitis is how Gobitis allowed states to force uniform obedience to a flag salute without having to prove that partial obedience would do. And this is a really important point. You'll see it carry through our later cases. Justice Jackson, who again wrote the opinion in the Barnett case, put it this way on 633 to 634. It is now a commonplace that censorship or suppression of expression is tolerated by our Constitution only when the expression presents a clear and present danger of action of a kind that the state is empowered to prevent and punish. So he's invoking the clear and present danger rule here that we studied before. It would seem that involuntary affirmation could be commanded only on even more immediate and urgent grounds than silence. But here, the power of compulsion is invoked without any allegation that remaining passive during a flag salute ritual creates a clear and present danger that would justify an effort even to muffle expression. So here's what this means for constitutional scholars. Justice Jackson would require a state to show that using a less restrictive means of achieving its purpose of national unity couldn't possibly work. And that becomes super important for our later cases. Barnett was therefore among the first cases to ask states to demonstrate that a less restrictive means was not available to them. But Jackson also says that the court's decision doesn't turn on specific beliefs of Jehovah's Witnesses. He says that since many people would find the compulsory pledge objectionable, a power to compel any of them has to be found. States must give reasoning not just to deny exemptions, but reasoning strong enough to compel everyone. So what the court in Barnett is considering is not whether everyone but Jehovah's Witnesses can be compelled to pledge allegiance to the flag, but whether or not the flag salute should be compulsory at all or should be entirely voluntary. One step in Jackson's argument that the pledge cannot be compulsory for anyone is to argue that a different standard of constitutionality has to be used when freedoms of speech and religion are at stake, as they are whenever anyone is compelled to express their belief in some symbol. So in other words, Jackson says that the sort of low level of scrutiny which Frankfurter applied to the flag salute law in Gobitis was not enough. Frankfurter had applied merely something like the Meyer test, with only a sort of simple add-on to it that a law had to be general and not target a specific religion. But Jackson says that this reasoning can only apply to run-of-the-mill laws. For those, all that's required of states is that they have a rational basis for their restrictive law. But here something else is required. But freedoms of speech and of press, of assembly, and of worship may not be infringed on such slender grounds. They are susceptible of restriction only to prevent grave and immediate danger to interests which the state may lawfully protect. And this becomes super important for our later cases as well, because Barnett is among the first cases to sort of rank order the freedoms, saying that some should be protected more than others. In this case, Justice Jackson argues that such a grave and immediate danger cannot be found. So there's no reason for restricting these super important freedoms. In fact, he says, the danger is quite the opposite. Our leaders can try to instill national pride by, he says, persuasion and example, but they can't try to enforce that pride in us for reasons that he gives starting on 640 to 641. Take a look at this quote. Struggles to enforce uniformity of sentiment in support of some end thought essential to their time and country have been waged by many good as well as by evil men. Nationalism is a relatively recent phenomenon, but at other times and places the ends have been racial or territorial security, support of a dynasty or a regime, and particular plans for saving souls. Jackson says this has happened throughout history, and he says, quote, down to the fast failing efforts of our present totalitarian enemies, end quote. So that you can see his desire here not to be like our World War II enemies was extremely important to Jackson. He wants to define the Constitution as a document which differentiates America from Hitler, or all of our present totalitarian enemies, as he says. Instead of what he calls enforced uniformity, the Constitution, he says, requires freedom of thought and religion, precisely so that these sorts of efforts, especially to enforce religious uniformity, could be stopped. So here's where some people object, though. Even if the uniformity that is sought by the law is uniform commitment of you and I to each other's own rights, Jackson is saying the Constitution won't permit that. He says on 641, those who begin coercive elimination of dissent soon find themselves exterminating dissenters. Compulsory unification of opinion achieves only the unanimity of the graveyard. Frankfurter, in Gobitis, had said this. It's on page 598. It mocks reason and denies our whole history to find in the allowance of a requirement to salute our flag on fitting occasions the seeds of sanction for obeisance to a leader. Contrast that with Jackson and Barnett. Those who begin coercive elimination of dissent soon find themselves exterminating dissenters. So Jackson concludes, and this is on page 642, if there is any fixed star in our constitutional constellation, it is that no official, high or petty, can prescribe what shall be orthodox in politics, nationalism, religion, or other matters of opinion, or force citizens to confess by word or act their faith therein. But many, many people question this starkly individualistic version of liberalism, and they wonder whether this is truly the best way to accommodate minority communities. So there are people out there who are concerned about the rights of minority groups who've claimed that our contemporary fixation on individualism in both law and society, a fixation that they trace back to Justice Jackson, they say it's in fact undermined the formative communities in which people actually live in a couple of different ways. First, and paradoxically, it's tended to place pressure on these diverse cultural, religious, and ethnic communities in society to actually conform to a single norm of individual autonomy and individual rights. So in other words, where Justice Jackson thought he was alleviating pressure by giving everyone the space to be an individual, there are people who argue, oh, quite the opposite. Individualism has actually put pressure on these communities to conform to an overall American, Western, white standard that is not their own. And they say, second, it's caused us to disregard the importance of participating in the national democratic community of which all citizens are a part and which protects citizens' liberties. So they suggest that in order to create a community out of diverse religions, ethnicities, races, and etc., we have to both embrace some sort of shared cultural norms, the sorts of norms that might be instilled by pledging allegiance to a flag, and we have to allow that some among us may require exemptions even from those norms. Not all among us, because those norms are important, these people say, but some among us, if they have particular types of beliefs. So in other words, they recommend the rule and exemption approach, and they say that's actually the only way to engage in true cultural accommodation. Jackson seems willing to deny that there's any standard that Americans have to be held to, even the standard that Justice Frankfurter had expressed, that liberty must be ingrained in our habits. Jackson won't even hold us to that standard. So critics of this decision wonder where a commitment to each other's liberties will even come from if there is literally nothing that can be orthodox in politics. I look forward to discussing that issue with you, as well as a number of other issues, when we meet together in class. I'll see you then.